tell your mother, the drone instructor shouted. No, we yelled back. Tell your mother you love her, ordered the instructor. I love you, my parents. Then jump, ordered the instructor. Lee squatted and leapt to a nearby trapeze, catching it in his hands. Later, Lee mentioned the experience had been more thrilling than the games he was used to playing online. Thrilling enough to wean him from the internet? Not quite. I'm not thinking about games now, so maybe this will help. From now on, maybe I'll just spend 10 hours playing one. These examples are an isolated case, of course. And recent research into the media consumption habits of American teenagers reveals some very similar but embryonic habits. Remember, these are the current habits of first-time homebuyers in 5 to 10 years' time. On average, with almost 11 hours of media consumption each day, primarily focused on TV, music, and the web, American teenagers now spend more time on screens and devices than they do on sleep. This represents a 4-hour increase over the past 10 years. And the first time that this metric was surpassed the recommended sleep average. Similarly, if they're using mobile devices, I include tablets in this, they spend an extra 30 minutes more versus non-mobile users. The average American teenager sends or receives 75 text messages a day. And of course, there's no need to delve further into the growing sense of digital overload. That's well documented online, I think. Interestingly enough, by those arguing against contributing to the noise. But the idea that we're now absorbing 3 times as much information each day as people did in 1960 is a firm reality, with very, very few scientists going down. But as the volume of information has increased, our brain's capacity to process it has not kept pace. So, as opposed to exploring the speed of content creation and how that's increasing, I believe it's a more effective area to explore is what is exactly happening to people's behavior as they consume the increasing firefox of information. I think this type of approach builds stronger agents and markers. So what's happening to attention spans, behaviors, and consumption habits? Let's hit the main offender in the rogues gallery of digital overload, email. Recent studies on how people use email on desktop computers during the workday found that on average, the amount of times people checked their email or changed windows between tasks, the average of this, was 37 times per hour. That's about once every 90 seconds. More on email there. Now, many advocate the idea of multitasking under the guise of increased and more effective productivity. But what I propose, and what neurological data is slowly beginning to support, is that forcing the brain to jump back and forth between simultaneous streams of thought leads to stress, the inability to think creatively, the inability to problem solve, and ultimately slower response time and ever worsening decisions. If you pride yourself on customer service, multitasking is your brain's enemy. Our efforts to do more are making us stupider. Let's look at a specific example. Dr. Marcel Just, a cognitive psychologist at Carnegie Mellon University, tested the brain's ability to do 2 things at once. Here's the first test, where the person was asked to do 1 thing. In this case, it was listening to complex sentences and then answering true or false questions. It's called a language comprehension test. The dark green areas indicate where brain activity is happening. Here we see it in what they call the temporal lobes on the sides of the brain. Those areas of the brain focus on semantics, listening, speech, and vision. It's also the place where memories are formed. So if you believe, like I said before, that memories provide the most shareable type of online content and the deepest emotional connection with your consumers, then this is actually a good place to look. Now let's look at another more physically based cognitive task. Subjects have to compare pairs of three-dimensional objects and mentally rotate them as if they were the same. So if I ask you to picture two spinning cubes, this is actually what's going on in your brain right now. This is referred to as an object rotation task. Again, we're seeing strong brain activity in the temporal lobes. Now let's look at both together, where the person was asked to multitask. We see activity again in both areas consistently, but overall, the brain's activity has significantly dropped. So the ability to actually process this stuff is much less and slower. French scientists Sylvain Charron and Etienne Coulet have also discovered that our brains struggle to process attention across more than two tasks at any given time. So when you think you might be multitasking, what your brain is actually doing is rapidly skipping from task to task, not focusing on anything for any significant amount of time. This is what's referred to as cognitive dissonance, brain noise. So while on the one hand, these incremental changes in our ability to rapidly process data are causing IQ levels to rise globally as information spreads more rapidly online, when multitasking, Charron Coulet's findings illustrate that each half of the brain focuses on different goals with an overall drop in performance, and notably without the capacity to process three things at once. You know what you're talking about? Facebook, Twitter, email, phone, let alone client, no? So is multitasking, especially in a digital environment, ultimately making us slower and less able to think? As we skip happily from social platform to social platform, liking, sharing, plus oneing, tweeting, pinning, are we being more productive? Or actually inhibiting our ability to think coherently and creatively. What does this do to how we work with clients? The key word here is actually happily. And the emerging field of neuroeconomics has a huge interest in what's actually making us tick. For many of us, we now have more digital relationships than real world ones. And the maintenance and management each of those ties can often outweigh the ability to perform the most trivial of tasks, such as eating dinner with friends in a focused way or watching a movie. Time with friends is shifting to mean something different. And I think many people take the idea of an internet Sabbath to heart in order to recharge and connect with their real world ties, such as friends and family. A new restaurant game is emerging, where people stack their iPhones together in the middle of the table in front of them. First one to touch the phone pays for everyone. The need to check our Facebook and Twitter streams has become a compulsion, especially in the era of an always-on mobile technology. And some compelling research into the long-term chemical implications of what these networks are doing not only to our brains, but also to our minds, is now starting to be published. Neuroeconomics, which combines biology, neuroscience, psychology, and economics, is beginning to provide some fascinating insights into chemical relationships between what a person is doing at a particular time online and the specific release of certain chemicals into their brain, impacting wide-reaching ideas around empathy and generosity, sharing. Many organizations are beginning to experiment with understanding the results of this research from the perspective, deepening their understanding of what neuroeconomist Paul Zak terms the understanding of human beings as economic animals. Is there a chemical relationship between emotional reactions, behaviors, relationships, and using the web? Zak's research uses the next up. Having undergone an extensive series of MRI-based tests, like the ones I showed you earlier, focused on measuring specific chemical release patterns when people are using platforms such as Twitter or Facebook, Zak suggests that social networking triggers the release of the generosity trust chemical into our brains. The brain is experiencing social media as if it was the same as real-world interaction. So while the technology has far outpaced our own brain's capacity to keep up, this is starting to actually be validated in terms of actual research now. What happens is that you get a synthetic essence of offline affection by releasing what he calls the cuddle chemical, otherwise known as oxytocin. And I always have to clarify, I don't mean oxytocin. Not quite that kind of thing. Okay. Oxytocin, interestingly, is also found to be the hormone release between mothers and babies that forges bonds between newborns. And at scale, Zak describes this chemical as a type of social glue, or even an economic lubricant, adhering families, communities, societies, and memories through the building of trust. Oxytocin, as a chemical driving its use of generosity, empathy, and sharing, is one way that Zak's team is beginning to concretely visualize the mechanisms that drive specific types of human behavior. The impact of the brain's chemical release of oxytocin, as triggered by emotional warmth, border on cynical when applied to an economic behavior scale, but the primary conclusion that is being released by having emotionally driven content and contact with others, specifically touch, even if that touch is virtual, is measurable and producing real-world results. Studies performed by Zak's team have attempted to answer the question of how social networking impacts the release of oxytocin into the brain. One such test, performed over a 10-minute span, monitoring someone using TweetDeck, without specific reference to anything special happening in their feed, they weren't in the middle of some huge QR code roll or something like that. They were just checking their news feed and responding to minor, sort of stress-free conversations. They saw a 13.2% spike in their level of oxytocin. And they saw the number of stress-related hormones, such as a slower heart rate, things like that, in their body significantly reduced. The use of social media produced a calming, soothing, pleasurable effect that was chemically measurable in the brain. Simply put, they felt good using Twitter. Perhaps this is why millions of people use these platforms. Our brain simply feels good on them. In other tests, people artificially given oxytocin over time gave 48% more to charity over those administered with a placebo. Overall, the higher the levels of oxytocin in the body is generated by emotional activity and the use of social media, the more reciprocal and generous the test subject became. So it's no wonder that the buttons are called like and share. It's a cycle that promotes the use of the networks, makes us feel good, and most importantly for their advertisers, keeps us using them all day. Their business model. The key metric that the majority of Facebook users return multiple times during the day to check in speaks to a classic need to emotionally connect with our digital friends and perpetually refuel on the release of oxytocin. goes further, proposing that this same research, adopted at scale, can be a concrete driver for economic development. He suggests that the deliberate creation of emotional experiences aimed at elevating levels of oxytocin in the body will build communities of the most generous, loyal, passionate customers. Sound familiar? I'm actually ready for a coke of oxytocin to come out. Just wait. Okay. Given what we see as the most shareable types of content across Facebook being empathetic, human interest-driven visual storytelling, it's hard to disagree with these findings. That type of content specifically releases a type of chemical into our brains which makes us more inclined to share it. And the more we do this, the more we want to do this. Perhaps this is one way to understand the primitive science behind how Zuckerberg's law, which suggests that the amount of content shared online doubles every 10 to 12 months, continues with such aggressive growth. Zach argues that societies with higher levels of trust have higher incomes, more stable governments, and the greater the number of positive interactions between people, the greater the acceleration of economic prosperity. It's a stretch, but he ties it to the specific release of chemicals into the brain across entire communities. So this is what I want you guys to think about. How do you generate that level of chemical release in your customers' brains? So given all that, one question that comes as a result of this research is that with greater and greater levels of oxytocin being released into our brains every single day as a direct result of the increase and aggressive adoption of social media, does it create a compulsive need for constant connectivity? A need to continue the regular release of those feel-good hormones into our bodies? However sympathetic, electronic connections are being processed as real-world connections in our brains. With no relations of physical proximity to these people in the real world, what does this do to brains over time, especially those growing up in an environment where social media is omnipresent and they have never known the world without it? One such counter perspective comes from Baroness Susan Greenfield. Here's Susan. Who's the professor of synaptic pharmacology at Oxford University, who argues that the need for constant connectivity and connection produces an increasingly short attention span. What? A compromised ability to actually produces increasingly short attention span. A compromised ability to actually empathize and results in a shaky sense of real-world identity as fuel on social media, creating what she terms an infantilizing of the human mind. This is what we saw with our friend Lee. She argues that because real-world experiences are inherently slower than online ones, especially the ability to process multiple streams of information across multiple networks, what results is a heightened increase in attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. More importantly, the validation of these social experiences, their impact on learning, and the lack of consequence associated with them are creating a generation defining themselves exclusively by the responses of others. How often have we heard that same advice applied to brands and personal presence? One of the biggest aspects of our lives impacted by a growing climate of external validation and chronic information overload is, of course, how we learn. If the brain is being fundamentally and chemically changed by our daily use of these social networking platforms, and we're getting smarter and smarter at filtering, editing, and refining our own attention spans, just think about how we react and retain information about advertising, for example. How do we retain the necessary information required to learn, grow, and master the things that we actually need? While social media advocates social media advocates promote the notion that this new improved capability to multitask is never before with apps and platforms and a new thing coming out every single day creates new paths of discovery and interactivity in the brain. Is that actually true? And how does that really happen? What we're talking about here is how customers learn and retain information. Traditionally, social interaction has guided people's ability to learn. People share things with us. But does it actually stimulate brain activity? Do we retain more information if we're undergoing that process as part of a group, rather than passive one-way learning through simply listening or sat in front of our desktops? Further studies on infant brains have shown that knowledge retention is only truly possible for the long term when accompanied with personal interaction, an aspect that has become a lot more important as we age. The findings conclude that adults must somehow be socially stimulated in order to learn at all. And the idea of manufacturing cognitive flexibility becomes an interesting one to consider. Think about this the next time you wake up in the morning. What percentage of the content you think you consumed online yesterday are you actually capturing and retaining? How much of the web do you remember from yesterday? I argue that it's very little. How much of it can you actually recall, and how specific can you be with that recall? How much of your content is genuinely retained by others? For many of you, that might be a real challenge. A lot of the criticism aimed towards the diminished ability to be able to learn is currently being directed towards an omnipresent screen-based culture, something fueled by social media and a growing mobile culture of apps, which promotes the notion of what's described as associative skipping, moving rapidly from topic to topic, with less linear and limited retention of any palpable or relevant information. With multiple sources competing for our attention throughout the day, the ability to focus is actually becoming a premium commodity. Even when we do achieve much sought-after downtime, it's still often spent with something screen-based, a movie, iPhones, the TV, or our much-loved iPads. To paraphrase Seth Godin's purple cow example, in order to even attract our attention at all, these media experiences have to be truly remarkable. How remarkable are yours? How remarkable do people find your presence on social media platforms? Now, iPads, in particular, have come in for some strong criticism in directly impacting sleep habits, especially amongst those users who read them before bedtime. Because they use a display which emits light, as opposed to the Kindle model of e-paper, which is something that can be read in direct sunlight, having prolonged exposure to this kind of abnormal light source, especially positioned close to one's specs, if you're reading a little bit, inhibits the secretion of melatonin, the chemical the brain needs to shut down for the evening. Melatonin is usually produced in response to darkness. And these screens send artificial messages to the brain, encouraging it to stay alert. A set of messages only amplified by the screen's proximity to our faces. As screens get smaller, we have to hold them closer. And as we hold smaller screens to our faces, and the degree to which we begin to live our virtual lives through mobile technology, sort of bathed in the blue digital sheath of the glow of the screen, the well-documented issue of eye strain obviously comes into play as well. Even when we're resting, there's usually a screen involved in our leisure time. Obviously, a reduction in the amount of screen time prior to going to sleep is optimal. But that's an increasing struggle for many of us in this room, in a culture of always-on, responsive social media. Many of us still wake to the ping of incoming alerts and the blinking, flashing alerts left on devices other than sight. We've willingly subjected ourselves to the tyranny of the digital world. If you have the truly noble goal of responding to each and every person who reaches out to you online with a no interaction left behind working perspective, can this actually achieve the scale? And what kinds of chemical changes are you asking of your brain in order to accomplish this? Now, the field of research into changing brain patterns based on our increasingly umbilical devotion to social media platforms is still very much in its infancy. But I think it's going to be a fascinating one to keep an eye on in the future. And I highly recommend that it's something that your marketers look at. These types of conversations build stronger marketers. Just as the pace of technological change is heralding incredible changes in connectivity, productivity, and information exchange, so our brains may be undergoing similar physical changes in order to accommodate even the smallest capacity for coping with what's happening and keeping up. Paul Evans, he's one of the key design engineers behind Google Plus. He now works at Facebook. He has a wonderful book called Groot. He describes a critical shift in understanding how the web is forcing us to think about consumer behavior. The classic sales funnel is based on linear, rational thought, with the customer progressing towards the conversion in a structured way. Many in the real estate industry have the capability of website application. But working with funnels is predicated on customers making rational decisions. How many of your customers make rational decisions? They don't. Most behavior, especially decision making, is driven by our non-conscious brain, which is why most of us, more often than not, can't explain why we did the things we did. If our past experiences drive our patterns of behavior, which are then stored as parallel neurological patterns in the brain, then new and unexpected things that don't fit the pattern, capture our attention. It might be time to do something different. Indeed, Evans suggests that neurological research is finding that our brains are craving such experiences. However, this isn't an excuse to practice more and more interruption marketing. That's not what we're talking about here. As the unexpected experience can often be a negative one. And interruption marketing is basically a race to the bottom of the bed. If, as Adams proposes, we make most of our decisions using the non-conscious brain, then appealing to our customer's rational brain with facts, figures, and concrete information is actually the wrong approach. People buy with their hearts, not their heads. And for many of you in this room, it might be time to rethink how you use data. Pushing more and more data of what you perceive to be your online audience actually runs the risk of creating cognitive burnout in the minds of those same people you're trying to reach. I argue that this is why all of the large real estate portals are more about searching listings instead of finding homes. It's not about data. It's about answering the fundamental question the customer has. What does it feel like to live here? Indeed, as organizations begin to experience more symptomatic fallout from stress-related digital burnout, fueled by these kinds of behaviors, some of them are actually beginning to adapt changes in behaviors that they're unwittingly asking of their own workforce, deliberately forcing their employees to switch off and create more of a work-life balance. Sensitive to the disruptive influence of the digital alert, Volkswagen in Germany are one of the first to implement such electronic communication for their entire team. 30 minutes after their shift ends, the company stops emails being sent or received from their internal servers, essentially blocking access to email and taking the employee offline in the work sense. The service is restored 30 minutes before before the workday starts the next day. With employee burnout, fueled by the lack of digital downtime, becoming a growing mental health problem in Germany, Volkswagen are attempting to balance the benefits of round-the-clock access with protecting and supporting the private lives of their employees. It's a difficult one, difficult productivity round to pull, especially for people in this room who are answering questions well into the night. Now that we live in a state of near permanent distraction, universal connectivity simultaneously aids and hinders productivity. As I mentioned before, the absence of digital activity, the empty inbox, the lack of likes, the lack of retweets, triggers feelings of anxiety and compounds feelings of emotional bankruptcy fueled by the release, or not, of oxytocin. Why won't people comment on my blog post? Email appears to be at the heart of many discussions around this problem. Email is incredibly effective at diffusing concentration. Atos, a French technology company, plans to eliminate all internal email by 2014. Why is that? Well, they found that a survey of their 80,000 employees found that on average they were each receiving over 100 internal emails a day, where only 15% of them were relevant to actual meaningful work. Similarly, Henkel, who are the makers of such products as Loctite, Blue, and Brightlight, CRISPR, declared an email amnesty between Christmas and New Year 2011. And one last interesting case of employee burnout happened early in 2011 with the stress-induced absence for a couple of months of Antonio Porta Rosario, the CEO of Lloyd's Bank. The Lloyd's chairman, who was dealing with stepping into replace Antonio, said he had an inability to switch off. Inability to switch off, or RETSO, is what New York Times writer Roger Cohen calls a modern curse. Antonio had said he made the decision after not sleeping for 5 days in late October. This is one of the leaders of the world's largest bank. And realizing that there was, according to his doctor, such a thing as getting close to the end of humanity, which is an interesting choice of words. He's now been pronounced fit by the Lloyd's Bank, by the Lloyd's Board, I think it was. But he said that he will change his work habits, presumably in ways that will lower the risk of needing to switch off before his body flips the switch again for him. So, given all these case studies, given the climate of increasing digital burnout at the expense of one's health, how do we, as digital marketers, agents, and real estate professionals, serve the customer better? A recent study by researchers at University College in London called out some seismic shifts in even the simplest online tasks, such as the ability to read. They conclude that it is clear that users are not reading online in the traditional sense. Indeed, there are signs that new forms of reading are emerging as users power browse horizontally through titles, context pages, and abstracts going for quick wins. This is why things like headline baiting become very, very important for marketers. They get clicked on. It almost seems that they go online to avoid reading in the traditional sense. Anyone familiar with the technique of link-bait-driven headlines will be familiar with what I'm talking about here. But as reading and consumption habits change, how do we future-proof our own marketing? British travel writer Peacock Lair suggests that the key to marketing to the next generation of consumers lies in the importance and exclusivity of stillness and digital downtime. He suggests that there is increasing value in being able to escape from time-saving devices that we so readily embraced in the past. So much so that black hole resorts, those with no internet access and the forced communicative disconnection, are becoming luxury items. Indeed, to economists, If luxury is a function of scarcity, and if web access is universal, then downtime actually becomes a highly sought-after commodity. This is the post-ranch inn in Big Sur, California, consistently rated one of the world's best hotels. I think it's easy to see why. It's a boutique hotel with a unique twist. Guests here pay well over $2,000 a night for the privilege of not having a TV or web access in their rooms. Digital downtime is something many are willing to pay for, and a vacation from the web in forced stillness and isolation from technology is fast becoming something luxury resort hotels offer their guests. Similar programs are rolling out across the country right now, with the Sheraton in Chicago even offering a BlackBerry detox service to its guests, which says if you can go 48 hours without needing to check your device, they lock it away in their vault. You get a free night's stay and a steak dinner. Pretty cool. I'm not sure about the steak. It's easy to understand what we're taking a vacation from. Nicholas Carr, who wrote that incredible book called Shadows, What the Internet is Doing to Our Brain, found that during a normal workday, the average American spends 8.5 hours a day in front of a screen, with the poor office worker enjoying no more than 3 uninterrupted minutes at their desk at any one time. Even when we get home, the volume of dual screen simultaneous use is rising as we chat to our friends about American Idol while we both watch along on TV. Unfortunately, we have more ways to communicate than ever before, but less and less to say. Simply because all we're doing is responding all the time. It's time to change that. But after spending time in quiet, rural settings, Carr found that people exhibit greater attentiveness, stronger memory, and generally improved cognition. Their brains became both calmer and sharper. And with an estimated 9 million Americans at risk of pathological computer use, it seems that there are surprising benefits of solitude, allowing the brain to recharge and recover from the digital gymnasium it spars in every day. In an era of ubiquitous web access, this is how your brain helps you become a smarter agent. Anyone looking to capture the attention and interest in the mind of the consumer needs to rely on the relationships between people and not the details of what's being shared or the component parts of people's behavior. Unlike news sites, it's not in our industry's economic interests to further drive online users to distraction. We need to have a deep understanding of how what we do makes people feel. In an era where simply too much information is being pushed at us, if most of our behavior is driven by ruthlessly edited, pleasure-seeking, emotional decision-making, then appealing to emotions instead of rational thought is not only the way to remain visible and relevant, but it also creates magical experiences for your customers. You know who's working with this? Chrysler. You see the Clint Eastwood Super Bowl ad? They are working with exactly this concept. Now, like all good marketers, I need to close with a call to action. So I ask you, will the golden age of intellectual discovery and universal wisdom spring from our hyperactive data-stoked minds? Time will tell, I guess. But I call on all of you today to use these data points, these stories, and these ideas to create the future of the real estate industry's market. I appeal to all of you to believe in your own ability to create exceptional digital experiences, to shift gears, and to have fun. I believe in everyone in this room's ability to affect incredible, beautiful, meaningful change for our industry. Because the answers to our industry's dissonance, disintermediation, and discord, and truly the way to instill confidence in the mind of the consumer, is to focus on the mind of the consumer. I believe that the answers to all of these questions are in this room today, which you guys. Anyone involved in building products, especially those centered around homes, needs to understand social behavior, networks, and ultimately how people think when they use the web. And most importantly, my message to all of you today is that life isn't a sequence of waiting around for things to be done. It's time for all of us to build beautiful digital experiences together. Doers win every time. Let's get to work.